Hi, my name is Damon Raebe. I'm with Dairyland Aviation out of Waupun, Wisconsin. I'm an aerial applicator, more commonly known as a crop duster, and Heidi Johnson and I are going to be speaking about the aerial application of cover crop seeds here in Wisconsin.
My name is Heidi Johnson. I'm a crops and soils educator for Extension in Dane County. And like Damon said, we're going to be talking about cover crops, and we think it'll be a good presentation.
Damon does the flying. Heidi,
I just do the talking.
Watches with me in amazement at what a nut he is. I'll let him know.
All joking aside, we want to just give you a chance to get your notebooks out and pens handy. Heidi and I have been working together now for about 2 years on, you know, following up with the practice and getting the, you know, research behind what it is we're doing. And so it's exciting to be here to talk to you about how we can plant cover crops with an airplane in the month of September and have them get to be hip high before we get a hard frost. It's very technical work. In order to get it to be hip high, you need to have a really short guy. That's my son Max. He's about 3 years old in that photo. I'm having a hard time getting him hip high anymore because now that he's 7, he's quite a bit taller. See, really, now we're going to start.
Yeah, Damon.
we're gonna basically focus on three main things here in having to do with aerial seeding. We're going to be talking about picking the right seed, going through that decision-making process, when to apply those seeds once you've made up your mind what you're doing. And then we follow up real closely with what happens after we do the seeding, and that's how we learn what works and doesn't work. So we are going to share with you a lot of stories of failure so that we can not repeat that. So starting off with picking the right seed, first you have to pick the narrow it down to a group of species that are going to work. So what we found is the seeds that we're having a lot of really great luck with and in the crops that we're seeding it into is in silage corn or in vegetable crops where there's an earlier harvest using grain seeds, whether that be cereal rye, winter wheat, spring barley, oats, annual ryegrass. Those seeds we're having a lot of success with. Corn and soybeans, because of the timing and when we're putting out the seed, it limits us to using primarily winter rye. We can successfully broadcast small seeded legumes like clover, any of the clover species in vetch. We can also do a good job with brassicas, your turnips, dwarf Essex rapeseed, and radishes. Those work well. The question is, if you're hiring an airplane to put out the seed, typically that's because you're running out of growing season. So while we can make these seeds grow, in your decision-making process, you have to decide if there's enough time for that to be of any kind of agronomic benefit. The seeds that don't work, I get asked to plant soybeans. They're large seeded legumes, need deep incorporation. Austrian winter peas, same kind of thing. If the seed is large, it isn't going to do well broadcast on the surface. So we're going to be focusing on silage corn and seed corn in this presentation because those are the ones that we're having very, very high rates of success. So now we're going to talk about what are your goals. So you know that you've got the grain species to choose from, possibly some brassicas and legumes, maybe, if there's enough time. So you got to ask yourself some questions. And really the main question you have to ask yourself is, do you want the cover crop to live through the winter? If the cover crop isn't, if you don't want to deal with it in the spring, if you want winter to kill it, that points you in one direction. If you want it to live through the winter, that points you in a different direction. Once you've answered those questions, you really get down to two base species that I'm recommending. There are other options, but these are the ones that if you were to ask me that I would recommend. The first would be cereal rye. If you're interested in having the cover crop over winter, real simple. Cereal rye is the most likely species to survive a Wisconsin winter. Raise your hand if you've raised winter wheat in Wisconsin. Keep your hand up if you've had winter wheat die. Right? So if we want a cover crop to live through the winter, why not just pick the seed species that's most likely to do that? If you don't want it to overwinter, we suggest spring barley. And you might be asking yourself, why spring barley over oats? There's been some research done. It actually dates back to the 40s, believe it or not. Oats is the fastest germinating. Spring barley is the fastest germinating cover crop seed, reference to oats. It grows faster, and it's unique in that it has a lower carbon to nitrogen ratio when it gets into the reproductive state, when it starts making straw. And what that means is it's less woody when it breaks down in the spring. Farmers find that much easier to deal with that residue, spring barley residue versus oat residue. A lot of people are concerned with the cost, and this slide is going to be, I'm very sorry, this slide we can't really see, but it comes from Penn State, and basically if you take the bushel weight of 48 pounds of spring barley times the number of seeds in a pound, and you divide that by the price for the bushel, and you do the same thing for oats, they cost the exact same amount. So you can have these advantages of spring barley without the disadvantages of oats for the same amount of money. This is where this is where the presentation gets real awkward. I have to stop talking.
We're gonna kind of go back and forth here just to keep you awake because it's after lunch. So I'm gonna show you some pictures of a study, some plots that I did with Yahara Pride, which is the watershed group in Dane County. This was from 2013, I believe. I'll show you some pictures. We did 8 different species or species mixes of cover crops, and we planted them at 4 different dates after corn silage. And the pictures I took were on November 10th, so pretty close to the end. So this just gives you an idea of the growth you'll get. So this is hard to see, but these were planted on September 10th. This is rye and annual ryegrass. You can see nice stands of both of them. These are oats and barley. These are taken from above, so it's hard to see, but both the rye and the annual ryegrass are gonna be a lot shorter and not put on nearly as much growth in the fall, whereas oats and barley are gonna put on a lot. The barley in particular was a lot bigger than even the oats. Like Damon said, that's been my experience too, is that barley grows much quicker. And these were about 10 to 12 inches tall by the time that we got to the end of the year. So now we're getting to the September 23rd planting, and this again, these were taken on November 10th, the same date, and you can see how much less there is of the rye and the annual ryegrass, and how much less there is of the oats and the barley. So this is just 13 days later planting. These were all drilled, so they were not planted with the airplane, which probably set them a little bit ahead as well. So you can see the big difference. Now if we get to September 30th, this is rye and annual ryegrass, and that's oats and barley. Again, you can see the barley is bigger than the oats, but it's still 20 days different from that first planting, and you've got a huge difference in the amount of growth that you put on. Even more striking is once you get into October 10th, the rye and the annual ryegrass are really small, and the oats and the barley are really small. So from this is where I suggest switching what you're going to plant the later that it gets. So he talked about barley being really great in silage corn, and if you can get it on early, it is great. Once you start getting later, like happened to us in some fields this year with a late silage harvest, it really is a good idea to go to rye. With this little bit of growth, there was nothing there in the spring, so you're not getting enough there to give you any appreciable cover. So it's better to have something like rye that can give you some spring cover. So this gives you, these were the ones that were planted on September 10th, and this is the reason that I don't recommend radishes after corn silage at all. These were drilled again, so set them a little ahead of what it would be if they had been broadcast applied. But this is the only amount of growth that you get on the radishes at this point in the season. When I look at that amount of root growth versus this is the barley, you can see how much bigger it is than the oats. And that fibrous root system at that time of the year, I think, is going to be much more beneficial to you than the radishes. So like Damon said, if you can get radishes in early, they'll work. But once you get past probably that first week of September, even much past September 1st, they really don't do that much good. And you can see the annual ryegrass and the rye are a lot smaller. Of course, the rye will get much bigger once we get into the spring. It tends to stay a lot smaller in the fall.
This gives you an idea. Damon mentioned him and I both really like barley. We showed you the fall growth on the barley. This is what barley looks like in about June. So you could see there's still quite a bit of residue here on the soil surface. And that's what we're really looking for, is to get enough growth on these fall and fall-seeded, winter-killed cover crops that they will provide the residue that we need into the spring. This was another part of the study that I thought you might just be interested in that we did with Yahara Pride. This looked at the nitrate levels of, this is an average of all those eight different cover crops. Cover crops planted on September 9th all the way up to October 10th. And you can see this huge difference, almost twice the amount of nitrates in the soil under the late planted cover crops. And this is, of course, the difference here is due to those cover crops taking up the nitrogen. So they're keeping that nitrogen like a sponge over the winter, which can be a value for you the next spring as they're starting to release them. All right, so now we're going to get into timing. That just gives you a little evidence of seed selection and what you might be picking, and Damon will talk about timing.
Thanks, Heidi. So in regards, we're really going to spend a lot of time in the topic of timing of interseeding. This would apply if it's done with an airplane or if you do it with a high clearance spreader. We're talking about broadcasting into a standing crop. The most important thing for that cover crop will be sunlight. And that we're gonna hit that pretty hard. But when everybody leaves here, you need to be thinking about how is your cover crop going to get access to sunlight. Don't worry about rain, and we'll kind of get to that at the end. In the case of silage or seed corn or vegetable crops, which I realize there's probably not a lot of canning crops in this area, but in the case of silage or seed corn, we don't want to broadcast those seeds more than about 2 weeks prior to the silage or seed corn harvest. In grain corn, we don't want to put the seeds out prior to the plant senescing to the ear, meaning all the leaves from the ear down are dead. And in soybeans, we want to do it no earlier than leaf turn. We can go later than that, but no earlier than leaf turn. And it has to do with the plant getting access to sunlight. So this is a picture of what it would look like in soybeans. What I marvel about this picture is I've never seen a soybean field mature this evenly before. So it's important to remember we're going to talk a lot about what happens to that cover crop plant and why planting too early is a problem. This is what we want it to look like in grain corn. Again, we want that plant dry up to the ear, no earlier than that. And now we're going to talk about why. So in this slide, we've got two bushels of spring barley were flown on September 6th of 2013. And give you a little background on this field. This is silage corn on 20-inch rows. And the yield on this particular field was 38.5 ton. This is a jungle. So there's a lot of concern about seed getting caught in the corn. There's a small percentage of the seed that will get caught in the corn. But in this high yield environment on 20-inch rows, most of the seed gets to the ground. So 2 bushels of spring barley on the 6th of November. This photo on this side, it's a little grainy and difficult to see, but I'm going to describe what's here. These are barley leaves, and what's happened is that barley seed has germinated, and that plant is competing for sunlight with the adjacent silage corn, and it has a leaf that's approximately 8 inches long. The root of that barley plant is only about 1/4 inch in the soil. And so what happens is, as it's competing for sunlight, you can see this photo was taken on the 25th, eventually it runs out of starch and other energies in this seed. And here's a photo taken 2 days later in the same place. Notice how those barley leaves are now folded over, laying on the ground. That plant is beginning to die. And I don't know positively why, but I'm theorizing that when you have a root that's only 1/4 inch into the ground, if the surface of the soil dries out for a few days, it's the equivalent of a drought to that plant. It no longer has any access to any moisture. So if we look at the date, we put it on the 6th. The intention was for the grower to harvest the silage corn on the 18th. That was the plan. The grower went in to harvest it on the 18th. The silage was still too wet. So here we are on the 25th with this silage still there. And on the 27th, it looks like it's in the process of dying because it's starving of sunlight.
3 weeks after after being planted.
Exactly. We're exactly 3 weeks later. We're beginning to lose the cover. Now, this photo was taken also on the 27th. And again, the photo is a little bit grainy, and I apologize for that. But this rye, or excuse me, this barley is about 4 inches tall. And I dug roots that were about 5 to 6 inches in depth. These plants have already put out their second, and some have put out a third leaf. So this was the planned time of the harvest on the 18th. The next slide shows you the stand. And I don't know how well it's showing up from your perspective, but this photo was taken on the 29th of October. And if you look on the left side of the image, where the harvest happened on the 18th of September, look how lush that cover crop is, that spring barley. That's what had access to sunlight. This is still a very good cover crop, but notice the thinner stand. We lost plants over here and therefore lost that stand. So this concept of needing sunlight can be applied to whatever crop you're interseeding into. So the reason why we wait till the corn has senesced to the ear when we seed into grain corn is because at that time, within a couple more weeks, the rest of the plant is gonna die back and it's gonna allow more sunlight penetration to get to the ground, allowing that cover crop to live. In the case of soybeans, we wanna do it when the leaves turn yellow at the earliest, because within a couple weeks, all the leaves will be on the ground and that plant's gonna have access to sunlight. So you have to leave, when you're thinking of broadcasting seed, you have to think about when is that plant gonna get sunlight. And so that's the concept. Heidi?
Right. This is the real reason Damon works with me, is because it's easy to get hip-high cover crops when you work with me, too, because I'm really short. So these are my hip-high cover crops that Damon actually seeded. This is another project that I have going in Dane County in seed corn. This is on the eastern side of Dane County. This farmer's growing for rank. And he's been really concerned about erosion the last couple of years, so he asked me to come into a project with him. So we looked at different ways of seeding the cover crops into seed corn. This was the airplane seeded one. Damon seeded it on August 17th. The seed corn was taken off on the 6th. And again, this picture was taken on 11/10, so November 10th. We did a mixture on this one. This is oats with a little bit of rye in it, 1 1/4 bushel of oats and 20 pounds of rye. We wanted to do that so we'd have a little bit extra spring cover as well. But we also used a forage oat for this one, which is, I think, why it got so big. But this is, I'm 5'3", so I'm not that short. But this is literally up to my hips by the time this picture was taken. It got really, really big. And we noticed some interesting things looking at this. You know, the harvest, Damon had kind of warned me when they went through and did the picking the corn, that it would look a little bit rough. It did look a little bit rough, but then it all filled in, and you really can't see a lot of damage to this at all from the wheel traffic. There were areas where they parked the wagons that were pretty beat down, and the cover crop had a hard time coming through that, but this part looked really good. The advantage in seed corn, obviously the male rows come out, and those male rows, there was really good cover crop growing there. So seed corn is really a natural place for cover crops to go, and I think the airplane is a good option at that time of the year. We wanted to compare different ways of seeding, so Landmark came out and airflowed some on too, and this is the airflowed cover crop. That happened after harvest on September 12th, and that's about this big. It doesn't look bad. We had a really good stand with that as well, and you can see the airflow. I got to ride in there with him while he did that. And then the rest of it, we tried to get it drilled at exactly the same time that it got airflowed, but I had to search every corner I could find to find somebody who wanted to drill this small amount of acres for me at this time of the year. So it took me until September 19th to find this kind man with his drill who came and drilled this for me. So this was drilled 7 days later, and it was almost as big as the airflowed stuff. But still, by the end, those were only about that big, whereas the airplane stuff was up to the hip. So it was a good thing. He's going to plant into it this year. This is a fully no-till farmer, so he'll no-till into it. So we're going to follow up and see how it works. But at this point, the farmer feels really happy with how it went, and he's looking at the airplane as a good option for him and his seed corn from now on.
Now, this is about 2 months growth. the airplane one was almost 3 months.
Right.
So
it's a huge difference, yep, in that amount of time. The other thing is Damon mentioned something about carbon to nitrogen ratio. This was starting to get to the point where it was almost heading out, which when you get to that point, you get the plant really changes and the residue lasts a lot longer. So we're looking forward to seeing the differences between that and the stuff that was in a really vegetative state. So that'll be a difference. The one thing, though, is I'm not sure, we'll see what happens with the rye, but the rye was so low under there, I'm thinking it's pretty well choked out. I couldn't find much of it, whereas in the other stuff, the rye was going strong. So that'll be a big difference in the spring, too, to see how that looks. Yeah?
Did that farmer with the big stand, did they take that out for forage, or?
Nope, he's going to leave it. He has no livestock. Okay. Yeah, he's leaving it. And I'm nervous. He says he's not nervous, so. he's been no-tilling for a while. He feels comfortable with his planter set up. He's never used cover crops, but he feels good about it. I asked people like Nick, and he said it'll be fine, so. So I'm hopeful going into this. It makes me a little nervous doing projects and then them having trouble getting it planted. Damon did mention the oats tend to roll a little bit more when you're planting into it versus barley breaking, and I'm a little nervous about that. I almost wish we would have chose barley at this point, but we'll see how it looks. I think it's you, right?
I think so.
Yeah.
So we kind of want to touch on this because this is a common question that I get asked. Growers say, well, the only way this is going to work is if it's a really wet fall. And so we put up the next slide to kind of dispel the myth. This is a chart where it's taken here from South Central Wisconsin. It's for 2013. And those of you that would remember the weather patterns in 2013, this is the deviation from average rainfall. So July, we were about an inch and a half drier than normal. August was about 2.5 inches drier than normal. And then September, you know, the time that we're seeding, and October, we're about 3/4 to 1 inch drier than normal. And we had exceptional stands in 2013. The amount of rainfall necessary for this is not significant. The plant needs about a half inch of rain, and that seed will germinate. Stands germinate in the absence of rain from the dew that's coming off the silage corn that they're in. Rainfall is not your limiting factor. It's going to be sunlight later on. So we've picked the right seed. We've put the seed out at the correct time. We're going to have a cover crop, right? It's that simple. That's what I thought. We started this in 2011. It went really, really well. 2012, even in the drought year, we had some really good luck. And then starting in 2013 was a good year. Again, a little drier than normal. 2014, we started to see some problems. And the first thing we're going to talk about are predators. Now, these, again, I apologize for the quality of the photos, but what I'm highlighting here is an earthworm channel. And what this is right here is a cereal rye plant. The cereal rye was broadcast, and we went out about a month and a half later to go look at the field, and the stand is very, very thin. So we start digging in the field to determine what happened, and we start to find these seeds buried about 3.5 to 4 inches deep in earthworm channels. So the earthworms are coming up to the surface, bringing these seeds down. Some of the seeds germinated before, and you know, established roots before the earthworms got at them. So we've got this thin stand. The next spring, I would follow up with the growers and say, okay, how does it look? And they're like, you know, last fall it looked terrible. And now this spring, it's really looks great. I don't know what happened. Well, this we didn't know in 2014. We weren't sure, and we saw it again in 2015. And what we concluded was that rye plant is that seed's being brought down that deep. It's germinating, starting to grow, going dormant in the winter, and then emerging in the spring. So, is an earthworm a predator? No, but it is going to move your seed around. So this is something that's important to keep in mind. And I'm not suggesting, you know, earthworms are extremely valuable organisms in your soil. We're not going to go after earthworms. This photo right here is a photo of a slug, and I don't consider that organism to be as valuable. We'll go right to the
next one.
Yeah, and here's another example of, there's an actual earthworm right here that was living next to that germinated seed. So here's what the slugs do. If you can see, this is a cereal rye seed, and what's facing you right there is the germ end, or where the sprout comes out. And I'm looking at all these seeds with these holes on the sprout end, wondering what's going on. I spent some time on my hands and knees just staring at the soil, trying to just looking at different seeds, picking them up, and all of a sudden I came across this guy right here. That's a slug wrapped around a rye seed, eating the germ end right off the rye seed prior to it even sprouting. So as I looked around more and more, I'm like, boy, this is a serious problem. There's a high percentage of the seed that's been eaten. Heidi, share your experiences.
So Damon seeded a field in northern Dane County this fall, and he called me and said, I seeded that field. If you want to go take a look at it. I was out there less than 24 hours after he had seeded it, and I had never actually seen this before. I had never seen the seed in person. I started picking up all the seed. It was all missing its germ end. And it's hard to find the slugs. If it's sunny out, they're not going to be out. But about 60% of the seed that I found in the field was missing its germ end. I went out the next day. It was cloudy. They were all over. And there's two different species. This is one of them that's a brown one. And then there's a lighter colored, really gross looking one that's kind of big. And they will both do this. So Damon and I, Damon had noticed that they don't seem to go after barley. So I got Partners in Production, was nice enough to give me about four tiny bags of different seeds. So I got winter barley, spring barley, triticale, and rye, and put them all out in different strips in the field. Just hand spread them. And when I went back the next day, they had eaten all the rye and the triticale, less of the barley. When I went back a couple days later, they had started to eat the barley. But it does seem like they'll eat the rye. The rye is easy for them. They don't have to deal with the cover on it, so they'll go right after it. Barley is a little bit more challenging for them. So there's more that needs to be done with this. I think this is going to be a big problem for broadcasting seed. Damon and I, at this point, tell growers, throw a board out in the field, go back the next day. If there's slugs on the bottom of it, probably shouldn't seed it with an air.
And I'd like to add, I would be looking at that point on what seed species you're putting out. Again, as Heidi said, the spring barley, because of the husk that's around the seed, it seems like they don't find that to be as appetizing. And so they seem to go after that. It takes them a longer time to decimate all the seed than the rye. But I'm with Heidi. It's, if you've got them in the field, you need to scout for them. If they're there, we're for sure not putting rye out. We can consider spring barley.
I think we need to look at that more. The mouth parts on slugs, I think that it's a lot harder for them, and especially if we have some sunny days after it gets seeded, they won't be out as much.
And this begins to explain why we had such good luck in 2011, 12, and 13. The surface of the soil was dry those years. And so the slugs need more moist soil on the surface to move around on the surface, right? And if it's dry, they just simply don't come up. Same with earthworms. If the soil's dry, the earthworms aren't coming to the surface. So there's just a lot of variable that goes into this, but we had, you know, dry falls, really great stands, wet falls, problems correlating to these two different organisms. Yeah.
And this may just be goofy, but, you know, for predation on some seeds, like capsicum or some kind of pepper irritant.
So we've done a lot of literature research to try to determine if there's something we could do to the seed to make it to protect it, and I have not found anything in the form of a pesticide that would be legal. Or any other form of a treatment. Maybe it would be like some gardeners use phosphorus. Well, the amount of phosphorus needed to get the surface of the soil salty enough for the slugs not to want to be there is cost prohibitive. And we haven't found any other forms of slug repellents that have been proven effective. Where people really work at this is in the gardening world. A lot of the research, when you go looking for it, it's actually garden research. And there hasn't been anything that looked to me to be economically feasible yet.
Penn State has been doing, the entomologist there has been doing stuff with looking at nitrogen applications. They recommend doing it at night because that's when the slugs are out. So his recommendation is three nights in a row at 3 a.m. spraying nitrogen. So I actually...
Did he clear this with his wife or his girlfriend?
I got to go spray slugs, babe.
Yeah. What kind of
good talk
is that,
right? Well, I actually got a chance to go to the National No-Till Conference this year, and I thought if there's ever a group of farmers that I would find one that had done this, this is where I was going to find them. So I asked a group if they had done it, and the one guy said he had, but he only made it one night. And so I don't know. I think, you know, you'd have to work that out with your nutrient management plan too. I mean, I think that's pretty cost prohibitive. So slug baits are possible, but they're also cost prohibitive. So I think that would be more on a spot treatment basis, or if you know there's a place where you're having trouble. You know, unfortunately, it seems like tillage works for slugs, which is against what we're trying to do here. So it's going to be a tough problem. And I've heard entomologists are reporting this is probably going to be a bad year coming. If you have slugs, yuck.
We just want to keep an eye on it. I've put spring barley out in the presence of slugs, and we've had success. But it's just something that we have to be cognizant of before we go put the seed out there.
And one thing Damon and I have talked about is maybe if you are going to seed with an airplane and you're going to do barley, maybe just try to time it right so there's a rain coming. Once it's germinated, the slugs aren't going to mess with it. So.
Yes.
Well, I guess two things. One, just a question is, what if you mix rye with the barley so they had like a diverted crop and they go after that and leave the barley?
And that is, you know, really what we were kind of doing ultimately by accident was just that. And it does slow down the pace. You're giving them something else to eat. And that is certainly a possibility, but there'll be some of that rye that'll survive. And if the grower didn't want an overwintering cover crop, now that grower may see that overwintering cover crop more as a weed. And but growers that are okay with that, by all means, mixing the two is very feasible. Heidi and I have talked about one other method that needs to get, there's some logistical concerns with this, but most of the rice that's planted in the United States is mostly planted by air. And there's a lot of that rice that's planted by air that's pre-sprouted. And what they do is these rice airstrips are along these levees, and they drop the rice seed into the levee for 24 hours and soak it. And that begins the sprouting process. Moving sprouted cover crop seed, for starters, getting the equipment set up to sprout cover crop seed is going to be a challenge. And then transporting that's going to be a challenge. But I think is going to put the airplane in a completely different place, and I think it's worth pursuing, is just going out there with pre-sprouted seed. I think that's something that we can work on, where you do some hand seeding of sprouted seed, and now we got to just figure out how to get that to the airport. So now we're kind of moving on to, you know, we talked about predation and its effect on getting a stand established. Now we're going to talk about grain corn residue. This is another complication that we're faced with. This photo right here is a field. We seeded from the left all the way over to this fence line on the right. The grower, I'd like to tell you that that's where I placed the seed. It was that perfect line. But what happened, of course, was the grower harvested silage corn, and then right here, the bunker was full, right? And so the rest of this corn was harvested for grain. This photo is of spring barley in this field. So what happened was we've got this spring barley growing. Harvest comes, you lay all the residue on top, You do this in the middle of November, the day isn't long enough and there's not enough heat units to get the barley or rye, doesn't matter which seed species, to grow back through this residue. So seeding into grain corn is effective, provided that the grain corn is going to be harvested early enough in the year. And so we've got some photos of it.
Don's projector is
So this was a scenario. We put 30 pounds of cereal rye on the 10th of September, and we flew it across the entire field. In this section, and another section right over here that you can barely pick out, are two insurance strips, okay? Those insurance strips were harvested on the 14th of November. This area over here that's very, very green, lush cover crop, that was harvested on the 6th of October. So the harvest date and the quality of your cover crop changes drastically based on this harvest date. These two green lines right here, this particular grower does controlled traffic. So those are tram lines. There was no crop there, so there's no residue. And that's why we have these two strips in these tram lines. Again, early harvested grain corn, normal harvest grain corn, no cover crop, beautiful cover crop. So what we're seeing here, that residue lays on top of that rye when at a normal harvest time, smothers it out, not enough heat units or day length for that to grow back through. So if you're considering putting this on your grain corn, it's absolutely an option, but only on a year where your harvest is going to happen earlier. And this is why we had such good luck in 2011 and 2012, and even in 13 by us. The harvest was done early. 14, 15, and 16 was late to normal.
That's me.
All right. Yeah, go ahead.
Ask a question about that.
Yeah.
That it looks like, from the pictures you have here, that the corn harvest was done, that the combine chewed the stalks up a lot, and they had the head set pretty low. The ground. Can somebody mitigate some of that somewhat by keeping the head higher?
Absolutely.
And yeah.
So I'm sure everybody heard that question. And so this photo right here is a non-chopping head. Okay. This individual knows the value of what's in those stalks, and it's difficult to see, but that head was up there. The previous one was a chopping head with the head really low. In either case, when you start, I basically tell growers, if you're going to harvest your corn after October 15th, it's very likely that this is the result. And I'm basically talking my way out of a giant market share, but it's the reality. And so it's just something that we need to know. And we've got growers that are actually, I'm not recommending this, but it is consideration. If you have a shorter day variety that you're happy with the yield and you can make that pencil, give it some consideration to make a little room here. But of course, you're going to know really in August what you're dealing with.
Good. Okay. So I need to actually start with this picture. So this picture is, these plots are right next to each other, and this is a picture showing you of a big problem that I've had in the plots that I've done with Yahara Pride the last couple of years. So these are right next to each other. They're the same bucket is here. The corn is really stunted there. You could almost see it here, how this corn right next to it is taller and this is shorter. Any guesses why? What was different between those two plots?
Nitrogen time?
Nope. Well, yes, from?
From the rye.
From rye. So rye was in this one. Rye was not in this one. And we had huge differences in height. This corn was planted green into the rye, and then the rye was burned down. I've heard from lots of farmers they don't have this problem, but I've had it several years in a row in the plots that we did. So it makes me just warn farmers to be careful with it. I know, Tony, you like it. So if you're starting off with cover crops and you really want to do rye, I just warn farmers to take it slow, take it easy, and learn the system a little bit better. There was some research done in Iowa looking at some of the issues, because this has been experienced by lots of farmers. We're not, unique in seeing this happen. But this is what the USDA and Iowa put together as their recommendations, and they recommend spraying it off at least 10 to 14 days before you plant your corn. And I think this is a good timing to go first. And then once you get more experience like Tony, you got a good planter set up, maybe you can move to planting closer to burning it down closer to when you're going to plant. But I think at first, to be on the safe side and to not have that stunting problem, it's probably good to plant early, or to kill it early. Planter setup is going to be important, especially if you're new to cover crops. You might not have your planter really dialed in right, so some recommendations they had was making sure that you're managing residue in the row, that you've got good down pressure, that you've got good closing wheels. All of those could create some of the issues that we were seeing. Don't plant wet. You can get a lot of sidewall compaction with the rye roots, so that might be a reason too, so make sure it's dry when you get out there. Nitrogen at planting seems to be a big issue, and I do think that might be part of the problem. The only issue that I have is that this really doesn't look yellow. It just looks small. So that's why I'm not sure that it is a nitrogen issue. I think it's probably several things going on. The other issue that we had here is he had used 2,4-D and he didn't get good slot closure, and we had 2,4-D washing down into the rows, and so he had a lot of, crazy looking corn growing, buggy whipping going on. So there's just multiple things that could be going on, but those are generally my recommendations.
Yeah. I got the yield results from this year. I did the same thing.
Yeah.
And it was about a foot, 18 inch shorter of the corn, but to take it to initial to final yield, there was no difference.
Mm-hmm. So that is a point.
It looks worse, but take it to final yield.
And I agree, and I'm going to show my yield data. The only thing is if you have a farmer new to cover crops and he walks out here and sees this, do you think he's going to do this again? Even if this showed up, this color in the field, I could drive up on this road into August and I could see the height difference, a color difference, and those kind of impressions from somebody new to using cover crops might be the last impression they have of them before they slam the door. So that's why I like to provide caution, especially if they're in a situation where they can see it right next to each other. The difference is striking. Yes?
It's always best to learn from other people's mistakes. It's a lot cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
But from what I've seen, having an adequate amount of nitrogen with the planter is very critical.
Yeah.
With rye. The other thing is have the row cleaner set so you have a good 7-inch clear spot in case there are slugs out there.
Yep. Yeah, the clearing the trash can help with that too.
Particularly the first couple of years I get like Tony, is get that rye off in time so you don't have the cutworm moths come in and it takes a little more scouting until you know what you're doing.
Right. And that's why I think starting, slow and getting used to it.
2.5 inches.
Yep. This farmer that I've worked with, he doesn't want to use rye anymore. I mean, he did it this last year. Again, he burned it down really early. Remember how cold our spring was? He found the one day where he got 8 hours of, it was in early March, we were going to have 8 hours of warmth, and he burned it down, and we didn't have this issue. But he doesn't like it anymore. He's with Damon, wants to use barley. So it's, it can change their perspective. Yeah.
One of the reasons to plant deep is that most 80% of planters are John Deere, and we have the two press wheels in the back. The pinch point is around 1 3/4 inches deep, and if you plant it 2 2.5 inches deep, then you're below the pinch point, and if you're using Keatons or something like that, you can see the bottom of the trench, you have less impact from sidewall compaction at that point.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The last point, allelopathy.
Is that going to be on the test?
Yeah. The last point that I have on here is allelopathy, and I don't think I ever would have said allelopathy was real until this past year. I had a farmer called me. He had a field that was half barley cover crop, half rye. He was going to put in a new seeding, so he burned it all down. He waited 17 days before he put his new seeding in. The half of the field that had rye did not come up. The half of the field that had barley did, and there was no weeds in the half of the field that had rye. You could even see he had used airflow. You could even see where the machine had picked up, and there was more rye where it had gotten going, and there was less weeds there. So I wouldn't say that every year. Our forage specialist for extension says in 26 years he's only seen that happen twice, but it can happen. And I think rye is known to be more allelopathic than some of our other cereal grains, so it's something to keep in mind.
I've had the same experience
here. Really? Really?
Not that it would kill it, but it would give it one hell of a headache.
Yeah.
And you can have wheat at the same time, same growing conditions.
Yep.
It doesn't seem to do that.
Right. Either. Yep. But
the rye, I'm told the smaller seeded stuff is more.
It's supposed. Right. The smaller seeded stuff is supposed to be more acceptable, but that doesn't make a sense in the case of corn and soybeans. You have more problems with corn. Soybeans do fine.
Yeah.
So it doesn't really make a lot of sense. But this guy had Roundup Ready alfalfa. It was a $10,000 hit. Talk about letting someone else make the expensive decisions or the expensive mistakes. So, you know,
the alfalfa wouldn't germinate in the rye you're resident.
Right. It didn't germ in that area. He had to replant everything. So. Yeah, so this has been these kind of issues, the corn that we saw like this, and then the alfalfa issues we had this year is turning off a lot of the farmers to rye in the Yahara Pride group. I mean, I think maybe it'll come back, but I think it's a lesson for when you have issues like this, it can turn people off, so we just need to be careful as we move forward. Yeah.
Again, I would go to clearing a 7-inch strip. If you're not taking rye plant material and you're planting deeper, so you're not getting in contact with seed,
yeah.
Your risk of alfalfa is way reduced. Now that we've got resistant mare's tail, water hemp, so on,
yeah.
God bless it soon, then the most effective herbicide is cereal rye at 60 pounds an acre.
Yeah.
There's been no resistance to cereal rye. The use of virtually every other class of chemicals, and in some cases, the Palmer Armor, five classes of chemicals.
I'm glad you brought that up. I do think that people that no-tilled, did you no-till your alfalfa in? Okay. It seemed like the people that no-tilled had less problems. This guy, the guy that was talking about with the alfalfa, he vertical tilled it. And so that mix and chopped up the residue a little bit and probably hurt it. I'm not sure. But all I'm saying is moving with caution so that we don't have issues like this as cover crops are becoming more and more used. I think giving people conservative recommendations can help. So corn silage yield, my cooperating farmer has a monitor on his chopper, so we were able to get silage yields off of the plots that we did. I've just pointed out, Tony, you mentioned that yield didn't get hurt. This is the four different planting dates. This is barley, and this is a cereal rye. They're not hugely different. I mean, you can see maybe a little bit higher average in the barley. When you average those out, it's 32 versus 33. But we've got this weird 39 here, which I don't know. We also have this weird 47 here. So this might be an artifact of the chopper monitor just not being very accurate. But it does give you a little bit of picture that maybe we're really not hurting yield, like Tony said, with the allelopathic or the problems with the rye that we had. And you can see these yields are not bad. So, yeah.
Do you have a control with no cover?
No. We had, this is, if you do the 8 times the 4, that's 32 plots. And I was doing nitrate sampling. So I didn't add on another one. I should have pushed it more. He also didn't want to have a no cover crop. So, yeah. All right, are you doing review?
Well, and I just want to touch on something. I want Heidi to wrap up the review.
Oh, okay.
The cool thing about these kinds of meetings, I go to a lot of different meetings throughout the state. We're here meeting and talking about a specific watershed, right? And there are growers in the room that have done these things successfully. Neither Heidi nor I want to stand up here and slow down progress. You've now can network with growers that have figured out some of these things, and anybody who's, what I've learned, there's a lot of things that farmers like to keep to themselves. When it comes to cover crops, everybody likes to share what they're doing. That's been my experience working with growers. So when we have people in the room that are doing this successfully, they're not having allelopathy problems, They're not having issues with yield issues. That's the kind of networking we need. It's not to say that this doesn't work. There's so many times that this works really, really good.
Right.
But it would be irresponsible of me to sit up here and go flipping through slideshows of all the beautiful cover crop fields that we've seeded without mentioning how we get them to look like that. Mm-hmm. So go ahead with the review.
No, that's a good point. And I do think that the best learning you can do is from other farmers. And so everybody needs to just get Tony to show them how to plant green, and then it's fine. All right, so I think this is just pretty much telling you what we covered today. Obviously, Damon and I feel like after silage corn, you're pretty much stuck with the grasses. We are not big proponents of using legumes. Damon doesn't mind tillage radish in early September. I'm not that big of a fan of it. I really don't like legumes in September. I just don't think we have enough time for nodulation, and they don't do any good. So we're really steering people towards the grasses. When do you seed? Like Damon said, no more than 2 weeks prior to harvest. He usually says to people, and he didn't say it today, but I like this. He usually says for a dairy farm, it usually takes them 2 weeks to harvest. A bigger dairy farm takes them 2 weeks to harvest their silage. So he has them call him when they're about to start harvesting, and then he can start seeding their silage fields. And so that makes sure that the seeding is done within the right period of time. Soybeans, when the leaves are starting to turn. Corn grain, when it's senesced up to the ear. And then when does this work best? Silage corn, seed corn is great. I think especially silage corn. If I could get cover crops on all the silage corn in the state, I think we would be in really good shape, because I think that's where we need it the most. And after that, soybeans can work, and really probably our most challenging system is in corn for grain, just because of the timing of the harvest. And then those late harvested, high yielding corn grain, that's gonna be pretty impossible. So I also don't think Damon said it, but you know, usually in corn for grain, the lower yielding fields are going to be better, because there's going to be less, not as big a corn, not as much residue, but it can work in other situations. I think that's it.
That's right? We've got time for
Damon, I've never been involved in an aerial seeding before. What should the grower expect to do at the time that the seeding is going on? I mean, do you need somebody flagging the roads?
Okay.
Somebody in an airport?
That's a good question.
Great, really great question. I think everybody heard that, right? So a little bit of logistics. What we need from the grower is we need a map. We need to know where you want the seed applied, and we need to know what seed you want, and then we need to coordinate where you're going to get the seed from, or if we're going to supply the seed. Those are all the logistics. When it comes to the seed, the sooner we can find out that you intend on doing this, the better. What I mean by the sooner I can find out, like, you know, this afternoon would be good. What happens is that as we schedule this stuff, we get busier and busier and busier. And if you wait to make the initial arrangements of where you want something seeded until a few days before we're seeding, it's likely that I'm going to be in Balsam Lake, Wisconsin, right? So we need to do some planning. And then as far as your involvement in it, after you've told me where you want the seed and what you want on there and what seed we're using, you just crack open a beer and watch the air show. You don't have to do a thing. We have the airplane is GPS guided. So the swath spacing is done with GPS. And we had some slides if there was time. Why don't you go to that last slide with the photo of the... but long story short, when we get all done, that one takes a little while to load.
Oh, is that what's going on?
There's that's a spring barley that was seeded into silage corn, and that was about three or 4 weeks after it was flown on.
How much does the weather body?
Okay, so we can't do it in heavy rain. I've done it in light rain. And I can't do it in extremely strong winds. I've seeded all the way up to about a 25 to 30 mile an hour wind. Yes?
Are there any species that will tolerate full shade that you can plant earlier on in like the late vegetative corn stage, or no?
I've experimented with crimson clover, turnips, dwarf Essex rape, and Burseem, and done those when in sweet corn, which is planted at a lower population and it doesn't get as big, with the idea that that would be the best case scenario. I walked through hand seeded three rows that were just between my knees and hip high, and it was a failure. So I'm not aware of a shade tolerant species that can live. You know what we're talking about, if you go out into your field and you look, I mean, that shade, it's mushrooms grow there, that's about it. You know, but I mean, it's a great question, because that's the kind of stuff we got to be thinking about.
Well, we've been doing research in Wisconsin on interseeding, which is using a modified drill to put the seed in the ground at V5. That's mostly, there's stuff going on at Arlington, up in the Northeast, and at Lancaster. And they've been mostly using annual ryegrass and red clover, because that's what Penn State is saying are effective. Mixed results. Herbicides are a big problem. John mentioned all these herbicide-resistant weeds we're getting. We want to use residual herbicides for that. If we're going to pull back on our residual herbicide program so we can use cover crops, then that might cause other problems. So growers are staying with their residual herbicide program, and that's caused a lot of problems. In the Northeast, they did 1,000 acres of annual ryegrass and had very little success, mostly because of herbicide interactions. So.
It looked a lot better after silage came off. The 1,000 acres up north looked a lot better after silage came off.
Okay.
The other thing is, like you said, the chemicals. Once we get 75% sure, nothing grows. So if we had herbicides that held for 60 days, till the corn, the beans, shaded the ground, we were good to go. Now with water, that'll grow 90% shade. Those days are over. We need longer residuals. We need a layer of residuals.
Yeah, and I think Penn State's research has found that if they didn't get that initial, put it in at V5 so those cover crops could get some initial sun. Like Damon was saying, the root growth, when they've got more sun, helps them live, and I think that's the same case with these interseeded ones. So without that, then they tend to fail more. I mean, I think there's potential. It's just got a lot more complications doing the interseeding.
The interseeding up north of Green Bay, they had one machine, a miller that they made an apparatus on, dropped the seed behind the 20-32%. And due to the weather this year, they were on early to get started, but they had to quit when the corn got too tall for this project.
Yeah.
But there was a tremendous difference from the 2 weeks from the front to the back on the viability of the cover.
Yeah, they had a whoopsie too that they did where they put radishes with clover and they seeded it right before the corn. The radishes started going crazy and they were out competing the corn, so they went and burned the radishes off. And the clover lived underneath, and that was where they had a lot of success. So they're kind of excited about that idea. I don't know how practical that is every year to think that you're going to get in there and burn your radishes off. Timely manner, but that's something that they...
We're on a learning curve.
Yeah.
You got a question?
What about being in its Oconomowoc area, would you have logistical problems flying the airplane by all the subdivisions?
That's a great question. I'm really glad.
Minimum field size?
So he's asking about minimum field size and where is it legal for me to fly? There's minimum field size. I actually bring it all the way down to 10 acres for cover crop seeding. I'll go in. We didn't go over it because of limitations on time, but when we're seeding, we have to fly above the trees so that the seed gets fully spread before it gets to the ground. So when we spray, we'll get the airplane down to about 8 to 10 feet above the crop, but when we seed, we want to be at least 50 feet above the crop. So now, all of a sudden, a small field isn't an issue for us, right?
Yeah. 30-foot trees is no...
No, flying right over the top of them, exactly, yep. You'll see me adjust height when I work an edge. If I've got something that overwinters, like rye in the hopper, I don't want to get it on the neighbor's land, so then I'll drop down to control how far it spreads. But the next part of your question is the important part, and that is, where can I fly? The FAA, as a certificate holder, as an aerial application company, exempts me from minimum safe altitudes to do my job. But that's only over other than congested areas. Okay? So when I'm over what they call a congested area, I have to be 1,000 feet in the air. Right? So if there's a subdivision of 30 houses that's on two borders of your field, right, I don't think I'm going to hit the field from 1,000 feet. So those fields I can't treat. and it's just illegal. I can work alongside of a subdivision. I can fly right alongside of it. You know, I can move over this way 60 feet, and that's legal, but I can't fly over them. And there, this gentleman that spoke before Heidi and I came up, Daryl, he was talking about, you know, trying to help coordinate this. These are kind of details that I've been talking to him about. If you're working through NRCS, if you have your county planner work, you know, with you, get a hold of me, get me a map. I can tell you within minutes if we can do it or not do it. That's another reason why I like, if you're considering equip, this is why I like silage corn. If you don't want to talk to me prior to the process, go ahead and sign up. You take your silage corn off and it turns out that it's an airplane, a field that the airplane can't do, there's still a big window to plant. And it doesn't have to be all of your acres that you end up having to get a drill through. It's a great question.
Now we're trying to do a large aerial seeding project in Dane County right now, and a lot of them are by Middleton. That's going to be an issue, so they're just working right with Damon to get it finalized.
We contact the sheriff's department prior to coming into any county that we don't normally operate in. It's a lot of phone calls. I suggest if you have this done, stop in or leave a note for every single neighbor by the field. People go nuts when they see the airplane flying. I watch people scatter in their yards like it's unreal. So what we're going to do in Dane County, we're going to get it in the newspaper. We're going to make people, it scares them, right? They're not used to seeing this airplane buzzing all over the place. And so we need to just communicate. Once people know what we're doing, it's not a big deal.
They like seeds better than pesticides.
I don't think it's those neighbors would be worth it not even having you put seeds on the ground. You like your barking dog?
Yeah. Well, I think we used up our time.
Speaking of sheriffs,